Removal of melted fuel is considered one of the toughest challenges in the decommissioning. Now, the government-backed entity overseeing the process has revealed strategic new plans. Officials from the Nuclear Damage Compensation and Decommissioning Facilitation Corporation are looking at three options. The conventional method involves filling the containment vessels with water, but that poses challenges of repairing potential leaks. The second option would allow workers to remove the melted fuel from the top of the reactor. And the third method involves creating a hole in the side of the container. Officials warn steps must also be taken to prevent radioactive materials from spreading in the air. They say high levels of radiation could affect not just workers, but robots and other machines. The Japanese government and the plant's operator expect to choose a method by 2017. The operator of the crippled nuclear plant in northeastern Japan is employing some high-tech help for the decommissioning. Officials with Tokyo Electric Power Company want to see inside a Fukushima Daiichi reactor, but it's too dangerous. So they're sending in a robot instead. They say high levels of radiation could affect not just workers, but robots and other machines. Three of the plant's reactors melted down after the March 2011 earthquake and tsunami. Workers haven't been able to determine the extent of damage or find molten fuel. High levels of radiation are keeping them away. TEPCO officials plan to put a remote-controlled robot into the number one reactor containment vessel. They'll be able to steer the snake-like machine around obstacles. They'll measure radiation and temperature levels. And the robot's camera will allow them to see the damage. Until now, they've used computer simulations to try to understand what's inside. They've gathered results indicating the nuclear fuel has melted and fallen to the bottom of the vessel. TEPCO officials hope that the robot will help them gain clues on how best to remove the nuclear fuel.
Engineers at the crippled nuclear plant in northeastern Japan are using some advanced decommissioning technology. They want to see inside the reactors at Fukushima Daiichi, but it's too dangerous for humans. So for the first time, they've sent a robot into the containment vessel at one of the reactors. Three of the plant's reactors suffered a meltdown after the 2011 earthquake and tsunami. Workers haven't been able to determine the extent of damage or locate the melted fuel. High levels of radiation are hampering their efforts. A remote-controlled robot was inserted into the number one reactor containment vessel through a pipe. The snake-like machine is designed to move around obstacles. Engineers say they were unable to move the robot after it traveled more than 10 meters. They suspect the remote control cable may be stuck or the drive belts are not functioning properly. But they say they were able to conduct checks on 14 of 18 areas inside the reactors. And the engineers say they've been able to receive images and radiation data gathered by the robot. Until now, they've used computer simulations to try to determine what's going on inside the reactor. They've collected data that indicates the melted fuel has fallen to the bottom of the containment vessel.
Workers at Japan's Fukushima Daiichi nuclear plant have been using robots to get inside the facility since the accident. They have managed to record vital information that's given engineers a better understanding of what's going on. But as NHK World's Chiaki Ishikawa reports, the work is difficult, even for machines.
In March last year, TEPCO engineers deployed a robot inside the building that houses the number two reactor. It took samples from the contaminated concrete floor using a drill. The goal was to study the contamination levels inside the building. A number of robots have already been used inside the plant, carrying out inspections and decontamination work. One of them sprayed dry ice onto the floors and walls, which was then scraped off along with the decontamination. Robots have also been used to study the condition of the containment vessels that enclose the reactors. In November 2013, officials confirmed for the first time that the robot had found contaminated water leaking from the containment vessel of the number one reactor. But there are limits to what robots can do. The inside of the reactor buildings are littered with debris. That makes it difficult for robots to move around freely. They often become stuck and are irretrievable. Another major obstacle is the intense levels of radiation. These are images from the inside of the containment vessel of the number 2 reactor. They were shot using an endoscopic camera. The white dots are generated by radiation. When approaching nuclear fuel, even robots can malfunction or fail to capture clear images. In another examination, engineers try to avoid such glitches by minimizing the use of computer circuits. However, the probe could only operate for 2 days. Government and TEPCO officials will eventually examine the inside of the containment vessel of the number 2 reactor as well. Chiaki Ishikawa, NHK World.
I think that all of the work that had been done with robots to try and sort out Chernobyl showed that it's impossible to use robots, because the problem is that the electronic systems that robots work on cannot sustain, they cannot function when the radiation fields get too high. Because the when radiation impinges on a substance, on an immaterial, what it does is it creates electrons. That's why it's called ionizing radiation. It's absorbed by the material, and it ionizes the material, which means that it kicks electrons out of the material. Now, the problem is that robots work on electrons. Your computer works on electrons. All of these chips, all the electronic chips that people use, all work on electrons. I mean, you can't have a system where the electrons are just randomly being kicked out all over the place, because ultimately the whole thing gets scrambled, and that's what they found in Chernobyl. And they tried everything. They tried the Germans had some very fancy robots, and then they tried robots from somewhere else, and they built their own robots, and none of the robots worked. They worked up to the point where they got into the high radiation fields, and then they just went mad, went around in circles, and sort of fell off the side. That's why in the end, in Chernobyl, they had to send men in. They called them bio-robots, and they just called up 20,000 men from the reserve army lists. And they put roofing lead around them and sent them in to pick up this stuff by their bare hands and throw it over the side. And, of course, they all died. You won't hear that. I mean, the international nuclear industry says that nobody really died after Chernobyl except a few of the firemen right at the beginning. But there's an enormous number of people who died because the Russians sent in these young men. And the young men just got huge radiation effects, and then they mostly died before they were 40. Terrifying. But this can't happen in Japan, and the robots won't work. So as I say, there's nothing you can do. They just have to dig around it, isolate it, put up a big notice saying mankind's folly, and keep it cool for another 1,000 years or however long it is. We'll be right back.
People have flocked to a beach northeast of Tokyo to take part in a wildlife rescue. They're trying to save 160 stranded dolphins. The animals are called melon-headed whales. They're 2 to 3 meters long. Reports say they're injured and getting weaker. People living near the beach spotted them and alerted the Coast Guard. Residents and surfers tried to get the animals back to the ocean and did their best to keep them comfortable.
I'm pouring water on them, trying to encourage them. That's all I can do.
I want to get them back in the ocean as soon as possible.
Some dolphins got a boat ride from police and Coast Guard officers. They went back in the ocean 10 kilometers offshore. Some of the others died on the beach. Locals buried them. Experts say a mass stranding in this area is unusual.
Melon-headed whales usually live in warm water. I suspect they somehow turned away from a warm ocean current and were panicked by a threat. They ended up on a shallow beach. That's a place where their ultrasound doesn't work well.
Rescuers are taking a rest during the night. They plan to continue their operation in the morning. The legendary monster that first terrorized the residents of Tokyo on the silver screen over 60 years ago is back, and he's taking on a new role. Godzilla adorned a 30-story cinema complex building. The creature has been unveiled ahead of the building's opening next Friday. Godzilla's giant head towers about 50 meters above street level. That matches the height of the monster in early films of the series that started in 1954. The district has appointed the globally known monster as its tourism ambassador, and it seems he is already doing his job to draw attention.
I think it's very interesting. I like it.
I noticed that a building was under construction. I was really surprised that it turned out to be Godzilla.
Starting next week, people passing by will be able to see Godzilla spew smoke and hear his distinctive roar.